First Baptist and as the ASMP director, thank you for your support for the ASMP. This is also a special time because of the homegoing of Brother James Calhoun, and memorials came in for him. I find it very befitting that this offering goes to the MBSF in Arkadelphia, where Brother Calhoun resided for so long and pastored for so long, and this makes this just a little bit more special. And again, we just want to say thank you for your support, and this is going to go a long way to help them further their cause there on the campuses of Henderson and Ouachita. And just pray for Brother Daniel and the students there as they continue to reach out on the campuses there. Pray for wisdom, guidance, and direction. Hoping to get back, I'm sure, on campus with the students, but right now online. And I just want to hand this over to Brother Daniel. It's a check for $38,000, or $38,476.04.
Appreciate you, Brother Jeff, and we're excited about this. This is going to be a huge blessing for us, as always, and we're so thankful to ASMP. We're thankful to First Baptist Church Cave City and all the churches that support and have given to this offering. And thank you. Thank you for your efforts, and thank you for this offering.
These kinds of offerings remind us that we really don't accomplish anything in the Lord's work alone. And so we do want to thank Arkansas State Mission Project, First Baptist of Cave City, Brother Jeff, and Brother Ron Kennard, and all of the churches that have partnered with us to try to help us get this building project finished at the MBSF in Arkadelphia. We're so thankful for your support and your prayers, and we're looking forward to having you in our building very soon at an Arkansas State Mission Project meeting so you can see the fruit of all of your prayers and also your financial support. So thanks again from Center Fork Baptist Church in Hot Springs.
Miss Allison here, Kids Choir. It's time to pause for a moment, and we're going to consider doing a virtual choir. I have missed you guys so much, and I asked Brother Sean to help me with the project, and so he obliged by writing us our very own song that we are going to make into a video to form a virtual choir. Can you believe that? We're going to do something exciting, even if we can't meet together. Now, this project is not limited to just members of Kids Choir. Any kids who want to participate, you just need to contact us. If you will email Brother Sean, he will send you the information. We have a packet that's going to be going out. It started coming out on Wednesday. And there's still plenty of time for people to participate. You'll get the packet. It will have information and details on how to produce your video and where to send it. It will have the music with a listening track and the music written out for you so you can print it out and be able to read and learn the words. You want to practice really good before you make your video and then send it to us. And we are going to have an amazing time. I think you're really going to like this song. It's all about hope and the hope we have in Jesus. I'll see you soon. Love you guys.
One day when heaven we with his praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hands that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. And one day he told me, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him. Rising again, living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever, and one day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Dying he saved me, buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Oh.
Amazing grace. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Amazing love. Now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to the tree. As grace flows down and covers me.
Amazing
grace. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Amazing love. Now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to the tree. As grace flows down and covers me, it covers me. It covers me. It covers me. And covers me. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Amazing love. Now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to the tree. As grace flows down and covers me, it covers me. It covers me. It covers me. It covers me. It covers.
As long as life is.
we've been there. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun.
Good morning, church. If you were with us or with me on Wednesday night, I told you I did have some news for you about our MBSF work, and I wanted to share that with you. But first, I wanted to give some thank yous to all of you who have sent Sean and I emails, cards, Facebook posts. We've received just letters of encouragement, and I just want you to know how much it means to us, how much it helps us as we're trying to figure out how to do ministry in this new setting and getting through this whole COVID-19 situation. I just wanted you to know just how incredibly helpful and encouraging you have been to Sean and I, and it has really been a blessing to us. And I know it's been confusing and difficult for all of us, but you definitely made a difference. Secondly, I want to say thank you to Sean, because every Sunday we have this service, and you, what you need to know is that we spend hours preparing all of this. We film it, and then he takes all of that raw footage and spends a whole lot of time, hours in fact, putting all that together, making it look great. I mean, he makes me even look good, sound good. It's pretty fantastic what he can do with a computer. And I just want you to know how thankful I am to have a partner in ministry who's been willing and without any complaint whatsoever to do all the work that it requires to get these videos put together. So I'm so thankful for that. And I'm looking also forward to when we get on the other side of this, being able to upgrade our video equipment and our editing equipment so that hopefully we can continue this online ministry after the coronavirus passes, because I really believe it's something that the Lord's going to use in the future. Thirdly, I want to thank all the folks who have been helping provide meals for Dr. Mike's clinic. You have been fantastic. Keith Williams stepped up and was again our chef, and Susan Oliver coordinated all of the meals and all of the people who volunteered to cook desserts or side dishes. And so to both of them and to all of you who have cooked and provided food, on behalf of Dr. Mike, all of his doctors, and all the people that we've been serving at his clinic, I just want to say thank you for that. That's a great way to serve our community through this time, and I wanted to say thank you. Okay, so now on to the MBSF news. We received, I traveled last week on Monday, Daniel and I, as you saw the video, we received this check for over $38,000. This is the final offering, and if you're not aware of how this works, we have a network of churches called the American Baptist Association, and the ABA churches here in Arkansas give towards a mission project, Arkansas State Mission Project Fund. And so we have hundreds of churches in Arkansas that give money to this quarterly offering. And we received another quarterly offering to help us finish this building in Arkadelphia. It reminds us that we can't do anything, accomplish anything alone, by ourselves. We need the Lord's help and we need the help of others. And so hopefully, maybe this week or possibly the following week, I'm going to be sitting down with Brother Daniel and Brother Donnie, Brother Sean, and all four of us are going to sit down and look at where we're at in this building project and hopefully get some things on paper and a plan for completing the work at the MBSF Center. So what we're asking you to do is pray for us as we plan and as we look at what needs to be done. Pray for the Lord to intervene and show his wisdom and help us to make good decisions. And so I just wanted you to rejoice with us, and we're so close to finishing this project, and we couldn't have done without the Lord's churches and the Lord's help. All right, stay tuned. The sermon's coming up next. Good morning, church. It is great to see you again. And before we open God's Word together, and we're going to be in John chapter 21, let's pray and ask the Lord to bless our time together. Father, as we are here again in really strange circumstances, Lord, looking forward to the day when we can be back together, we ask you to help us to focus on this text. Help us, Father, to be responsive to your Holy Spirit as you work in our hearts and minds with your Word. Bring us to a place of clarity and understanding, and bring us to a place where we're ready to obey and receive your grace, receive your mercy, and also, Lord, receive your admonition. Father, we just want to say together as a people, as we're separated, we just want to say, Lord, speak. Your servants are listening this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Can you imagine what it was like for Peter the night of Jesus' burial? I wonder if he slept any that night as he replayed the events of the previous 12 to 18 hours. You can imagine it just went over and over again. All the promises he made, the violence and the blood, and also his willingness to act as if he had never even met Jesus. And now Jesus was dead. And then Sunday morning, the unthinkable happened. The women show up from the tomb early that morning and said that an angel had risen from the dead. In fact, the angel even told them, go tell his disciples and Peter that he has risen from the dead. Mary Magdalene came to James and to John and Peter and all those disciples and told them that she had actually seen the Lord. And Peter couldn't believe his ears. So Peter rushed to the empty tomb with John. And of course, John waited at the outside, and impetuous Peter rushed in and saw the empty tomb for himself. And even then, he wasn't convinced that Jesus was resurrected. It was a chaotic day. A lot of things happening. People going in all sorts of directions. There was mourning and weeping and confusion. And sometime between these events in the early morning and Jesus' appearance to the disciples in the upper room in the evening, Jesus Christ, the risen Lord, appeared privately and personally to Peter. You can see the evidence for that in Luke chapter 24, verses 33 through 35, and also 1 Corinthians 15 in verse 5. So Jesus had a private, personal meeting with Peter, of which we have no record or testimony as far as what was said or discussed. Then after the disciples on the road to Emmaus share their story, Jesus appears in the upper room, and remember, Thomas wasn't there at that first meeting. And then a week later, Jesus appears again with these same people in the upper room, except this time with Thomas present. But when you look at John chapter 21, and as you think about the events coming into the book of Acts, there are questions that need to be answered. And one question that is hanging awkwardly in the air in all these post-resurrection appearances is, what about Peter? I mean, it's even implied when the angels told the women to go tell the disciples and Peter that Jesus has risen from the dead, pointing out that Peter was kind of a special case among the apostles. Look, they all blew it that night. All of them did. All of them scattered. All of them ran. Jesus is just pointing out the fact, and the Word is just pointing out the fact, that Peter was the leader, and he held great responsibility. He was the unquestioned leader of the apostles. He was also a colossal failure on the night of Jesus' betrayal, arrest, and crucifixion. All these men, including Peter, could remember the early days. The early days when they heard Jesus call them personally. Those fishermen, James and John and Peter and Andrew, heard that voice where he said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. But now, in the wake of betrayal and arrest and crucifixion and resurrection, those early days are a distant memory. Jesus is alive, but what about Peter? Will he ever preach again? And will his entire life be completely swallowed up and defined by his failure? Well, let's read our text and begin to answer that question this morning. John chapter 21, verse 1. After these things, Jesus showed himself again, manifested himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. This is the Sea of Galilee. And in this way, he showed himself. Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. And they said to him, we are going with you also. So they went out immediately, got into the boat, and that night they caught, say it out loud, yeah, nothing. Nothing. But when the morning had now come, so daybreak is just beginning to happen. It's just right after dawn, early, early in the morning. Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Then Jesus came to them, children, boys, have you any food? They answered him, no. And he said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. Now listen. Therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved, that's John, said to Peter, it is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he had removed it, and he plunged into the sea. But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from land, but about 200 cubits, dragging the net with fish. And then as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid on it, and bread. And Jesus said, bring some of the fish which you have just caught. So Simon Peter went up and dragged the net to land full of large fish, 153. And although there were so many, the net was not broken. And Jesus said to them, come and eat breakfast. Yet none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you, knowing that it was the Lord. Jesus then came and took the bread and gave it to them, and likewise the fish. This is now the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. It's important as you come into this passage that John is giving us the different appearances that he is choosing to show in his gospel to prove the resurrection of Jesus. And so he points out that this is the third time that Jesus has made himself available and apparent and manifested himself to his disciples. This is the third time in John's gospel he reveals himself to the apostles. Now by this time, Peter has already seen the resurrected Christ three times. One time privately and two times publicly. Now the scene moves from not in Jerusalem, but now they're in Galilee. Because remember, when Jesus first resurrected, he told them to meet them at a mountain in Galilee. So the disciples were moving to Galilee and waiting for another appearance of Jesus. Peter presumably has already been reconciled privately to Jesus. But he has not been recommissioned publicly. And this is what chapter 21 is all about. This is all about Peter being recommissioned to the ministry that he has been called to. The ministry of being a fisher of men and a shepherd of the sheep. Now, Peter's influence is so obvious in this passage. Peter says, I'm going fishing. And what did the other apostles do? We are going with you also. Now, there's a lot of conjecture about whether or not Peter was in sin here. You know, we have 40 days of ministry where Jesus is appearing to the apostles, and he's not giving them a timeline of when he's going to appear. So a lot of people think that Peter was in sin, and Peter was saying, I'm going back to my first profession of fishing, and I'm leaving Jesus, and I'm going fishing, enough with this resurrection stuff. I don't think that's probably what was happening. I don't know if Peter was in sin. If the Bible does not tell us, and I can't see his heart, of course. It also could be very possible that Peter is a fisherman, and they're waiting for Jesus to appear there in Galilee. And what do fishermen do? How do they make a living? They fish. So maybe while they're waiting for Jesus to appear, these fishermen go back to work to make some money for their families. I don't know. And that's not the point of the story, okay? And this again, we need to make sure we understand how the Bible works. We could spend a whole day discussing about whether or not Peter was in sin to say, I'm going fishing. The reality is, he went fishing, and Jesus interrupted his fishing. And so as you look at the point of this passage, the point of this passage is that Peter is no longer a fisherman, even if he thinks of himself that way. Jesus has called him to be a fisher of men. And Jesus' call on his life changes everything. It changed everything 3 years prior when, in Luke 5, he called Peter to be a fisher of men. It changed whenever he called all those fishermen to follow him and become fishers of men. So let's look at the miracle first in verses 1 through 6. In verse 3, these commercial fishermen decide to get into a boat and they fished all night and they caught, say it again, nothing. Commercial fishermen raised on the Sea of Galilee, knowing all the nuances, all the tricks of the trade, and they caught nothing. Now that should have brought to mind another night when they caught nothing in Luke chapter 5. In verse 4, the dawn is beginning to break, and Jesus is on the shore, but they didn't recognize him. And this is often the case in Jesus' glorified body. He either restrained people from being able to see him. He didn't manifest himself clearly. This could just be a simple fact that it was early in the morning and they couldn't see the shore. But Jesus was standing on the shore waiting for them. And a voice comes from the shore. And in verse 5, and Jesus says, "Children, have you any food?" And literally what Jesus is asking, "Boys, hey guys, you catch anything tonight?" And of course the answer was, "No." So then Jesus gives a command, and it's a command with a promise. Now look at this. Jesus says, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat." So obviously they were working on the left side of the boat. And for you to understand, they would have had a large boat, a large vessel out in the sea that they were fishing from. The boat that they come to shore in would be a smaller little dinghy or a small little boat that they would be able to get to the shore in. So they were in the big boat, and obviously they were fishing on the left side of that boat. And Jesus says, just drop your nets over to the right side of the boat. He gives them that command, and he tells them, "You will find some." Jesus wasn't a fisherman, but he is certainly the king of the fish, right? So he commands them. So just think about what Jesus has ordained and orchestrated. He's already orchestrated that they wouldn't find any fish all night long. Jesus knew exactly what he was going to do when he appeared on the shores of Galilee to these fishermen. Jesus has already orchestrated the fact that they would work all night long and catch nothing. And then Jesus commands them to simply change the side of the boat and cast one time. Now, I don't know how many times they cast their nets over the course of the evening, how many times they changed. You know how I went fishing last week, and I changed. One of my buddies asked, "Well, what'd you fish with?" And I said, "Everything in my tackle box." Because I would change baits. If I wasn't getting a bite, I would change bait. And you know these commercial fishermen, they adjusted. They did this, they did that. They put their lights here, they put their lights there, and they caught nothing. And then with one command and one cast, they catch an amount of fish that they couldn't even get into the boat. In fact, verse 11 tells us, you know, when you go fishing, the two questions people always ask when you go fishing, how many did you catch? That's important. But not only how many, how big, right? We want to know those two bits of information. Well, John tells us, because John was an eyewitness, that these weren't little fish. There was 153, and they were large and numerous. So these were big fish. So much so that part of the miracle is not only the fact that they found the fish, the miracle is also that their net didn't break, dragging it to shore. So this miracle jars John's memory as they are standing there in the boat. This miracle jars John's memory. In fact, I'm going to turn back and read Luke chapter 5. "So it was, as the multitude pressed about by him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret." This is the same Sea of Galilee. This is Luke 5, verse 1. "He saw two boats standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and he asked him to put out a little from land, and he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. And when he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, 'Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch.' But Simon answered him, 'Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net.' And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help him. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, 'Depart from me, for I am a sinful man.' And all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid." I love this. "Don't be afraid of me. I know you're a sinner. I know I'm holy." That's what Jesus is saying. Don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men. So this miracle jars the memory of John the Apostle. And John leans over to Peter. And he says these wonderful words. "It is the Lord." And of course, you know what happens next. Peter puts on his outer cloak and goes swimming. The fisherman goes swimming so that he could be with Jesus. What's the point of this miracle? The point of this miracle and the point of this story is, Peter, you are not a fisherman. Peter, you are a fisher of men. Despite your failure, despite what you've done, my call on your life overrules your own failure. So then you come into the meaning of this miracle in verses 7 through 14. And the key point, the key turning point in this passage, in this miracle and the meaning of it, is when the men simply obey what Jesus said. Now, at the point that they obeyed, they didn't even know it was Jesus, but they threw their net on the other side and obeyed. And everything flows from this obedience. It's just simply responding to the obedient, to the word and the call of Jesus. And these men experienced some things that you and I should experience too. So here's the meaning. First of all, they experienced multiplication. They had fished all night and caught nothing. They obeyed Jesus' one command and they catch a multitude of large, numerous fish. 153 of them. So fishing all night without Jesus? Zippo. Casting one time with Jesus? A net full. This was the lesson in Luke 5 and in John chapter 21. Multiplication. And in fact, this is a symbol of what Peter's ministry would be like going forward. Peter's being taught, look, you're not going to be fishing for fish anymore. You're going to be fishing for men, and I'm going to multiply my work through you. You're going to see people respond and repent and be saved. And this points out something for us, is that multiplication and ministry and our lives, it's not about money. It's about people. It's about people. At the end of our lives, what's going to matter most is what we've done for Jesus and the people that we've influenced for Jesus. It's not about our money. It's not about our stuff. It's not about our things. It's not about our name. It is about the life God has given us and using that life to glorify and magnify Jesus so that others might know him. So Jesus allows Peter and these fishermen to experience multiplication. Secondly, they experience realization. It was only after they obeyed the commands of Jesus that John realized it was Jesus on the shore. It was only then that his eyes were really open. Peter, overcome with zeal, plunges into the sea to see Jesus Christ. And this is so beautiful, because in Luke 5, Peter falls at Jesus' feet and says, "Depart from me. I'm a sinful man." But Peter has now learned, I don't want to run from Jesus. I don't want Jesus to leave me. I want to be with Jesus at any cost. Even in spite of my failures, I want to be with Jesus. In this moment, John and these fishermen, these seven disciples, some of the closest apostles, the closest followers of Jesus, his apostles, were realizing something about Jesus, that he is more gracious than you could ever imagine. They were fishing. He gave them this incredible catch, and he's standing on the shore and welcoming them in to fellowship. John and Peter and all of these men are realizing just how deep and how wonderful the grace of Jesus Christ is. Jesus had not abandoned Peter, even though Peter abandoned him. Peter's failure wasn't final, and the proof was that there he was, on the shore, waiting and watching before their eyes, and then welcoming them to a meal. In our failure, we need to come to that realization of just how good the grace of God is. That he is the God of second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, and ninth chances. They also got to experience the meaning of this, not only multiplication, realization, but also provision. In verses 8 and 9, when they get to the shore, this is crazy. Think about this. This is the resurrected, risen Lord Jesus Christ in a glorified body. And you know what he did? He gathered wood, and he made a fire, and he got some bread, and he got some fish, and he cooked them breakfast in the dark, no doubt, because now it's just barely past daybreak. He prepares a meal for these fishermen who couldn't even stay awake while he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. He provided for them fire, fish, and bread in verse 9. And then Jesus in verses 11 and 12 invites them and he says, come and eat breakfast. I know you've been working all night and it's been really hard and frustrating. Come on over here and eat some breakfast with me. And then one of the, again, and this would have jarred Peter's memory and the apostles, all of these men's memory to the night of Jesus' betrayal and arrest. In verse 13, Jesus then came and took the bread and gave it to them. And likewise, the fish. Can you imagine what that was like? They weren't saying a word because they knew it was the Lord. They were not saying a word. And Jesus silently goes around handing out fish and bread to all these apostles as they sit there in joy and fellowship as Jesus provides for them. Now, this would be, I think, a lesson for Peter. Peter has a wife. He is responsible for his mother-in-law, because she was in the home, it appears, if you read the early Gospels that tell us about. So Peter had a family. He had responsibilities. He had people that he had to take care of. And one of the things in the back of Peter's mind, well, if Jesus is resurrected and if Jesus is going to leave us and go back to heaven, how can I fish for men and take care of my family? I think this was a lesson for Peter. Peter, if I call you to do something, if I ask you to do something, I will provide the means necessary to do it. Peter, I'm going to provide for you not only a catch. Think about this for a second. He didn't just provide them breakfast, like one little meal. Jesus provided a breakfast for them that morning. That's great, but what about lunchtime? Well, they had 153 large fish that they could take to market. And they could put those fish, they could dry those fish and preserve those fish, they could sell those fish. I think this is a lesson for Peter about provision. Jesus not only provided them a meal, Jesus provided them so much more. And Jesus is promising to constantly provide our needs as we walk forward in obedience to him. That's why church, one of the most important lessons we have to learn as a church, not only as individuals. The first question is not, how much does it cost? That is not the first question. The first question is, what has Jesus commanded us to do? What is Jesus' will for my life, for your life, for this church? And when we determine what that is and we understand what that is, then we go do it. And we let Jesus worry about the cost. Now, I know that's backwards because you're taught to think different. You know, you're in the world, we're taught to think about how much it costs. No. If Jesus calls us, commands us, and asks us to step forward in faith and obedience to him, we respond and we wait on his provision. And I hope that you've experienced that in your personal life. As you've given your time and your effort, and you've given, maybe you're a Sunday school teacher, and it just extracts so much from you, but then God shows up with his grace and does something you could never do. Well, that's what God wants us to experience. His provision, not only financially, but his provision emotionally and spiritually and materially as we step forward in faith and do what he's asked us to do. Peter, I'm asking you to be a fisher of men. Trust me, I'll take care of you. That's the lesson Jesus is giving Peter in this moment. He also gives him the lesson of cooperation. And this is absolutely fantastic. I love these words. Jesus said to them in verse 10, bring some of the fish which you have caught. Now think about that. And what I love about this is the other apostles just kind of sit there. And Peter runs down to the little boat and drags those 153 fish out. Now think about that for a second. That tells you something about Peter, doesn't it? He was a strong, brawny guy. He drug those fish and brought some of those fish. And it's so funny, the words of Jesus, the fish you have caught. Now let's think about this. What kind of fishing had they done? How successful were they over the course of that whole night? They caught nothing. Yet Jesus says, throw it on the right side, one cast, and they catch a net full. And this is how ministry and how working for the Lord Jesus, how making disciples, how serving and loving others works. This is not our church. This is not my ministry. These are not my sheep. That Sunday school class full of kids aren't your kids. This is the Lord's harvest. These are the Lord's sheep. And so he invites us to enter his harvest and work with him. He allows us to come alongside him and cooperate. He allowed Peter and James and John and those other disciples to catch all those fish. But who was responsible for the catch? Who? Jesus was. And in that moment, hopefully Peter and all of these men began to really understand what it means to fish for men. Church, we are not responsible for the results. We're responsible for the obedience and faithfulness. Jesus is responsible for the catch. It's his harvest. It's his kingdom. And he invites you and me to come stand alongside him, even though we don't deserve it, and cooperate with him and invite people into his kingdom. He invites us to join him in his work. Now, I want you to understand something. Peter would eventually experience all of these things as he submitted to the fisher, to be the fisher of men Jesus called him to be. He would experience multiplication, a greater realization of who Jesus is and the grace of Jesus. He would experience provision over and over and over. He would experience cooperation as he watched God do things through him that he could never have imagined. Peter would soon experience the reality of this symbolic lesson. Just think about this. Just a few days later, after the coming of the Holy Spirit, Peter would watch as thousands of people repented and believed in Jesus Christ. And this disciple who was unwilling to stand up for Jesus publicly stood in front of some of the people who called out for Jesus' crucifixion, and he watched God break their hearts, open their minds, and bring them to salvation. Peter watched as 120 people in a small little church filled with fear blossomed and grew into a church of probably 15,000 at the very least. And here we are 2,000 years after Peter's death, and we're still reading about this story, and we're still reading the letters that Peter wrote and marveling at what God did through the Apostle Peter in Acts chapters 1 through Acts chapter 12. Peter learned that his failure wasn't final. He eventually became the fisher of men that Jesus called him to be. Peter's failure wasn't final, and the failure of all these fishermen wasn't final. In spite of their failure, Jesus was still calling them to be fishers of men. Okay, well, let's wrap all this up and make some application. Number one, if Peter's failure and the rest of these men's failure, if that wasn't final, then neither is yours. I mean, imagine of all the things you could do to fail Jesus, compare it to what Peter did. If Peter's failure wasn't final, then neither is yours. God has to use failing, sinful people. Do you know why? I'm getting ready to go so deep. Are you ready, church? Hold on. Everybody ready? Okay. God has to use failing, sinful people because that's the only kind of people available. This is who we are. We're not who God intended us to be. This is what sin has done to us. So you can't let your past failures determine whether or not you're going to move forward in obedience to Jesus Christ. Secondly, I want to make sure you understand this. If you're going to try to follow Jesus and do what he asks you to do, you are going to fail. There are going to be times when you fall. I'm not mean ultimate failure. I'm saying there's going to be seasons and times where you miss the mark. And in fact, one of the things that I have experienced in my life, that even when I obey Jesus, I can't obey completely, fully, and perfectly, even on my best day. I don't fully follow the example and the leadership of Jesus. So failure is a part of following Jesus. And please listen to me. Perfection is not the goal. You see, God's not after your perfection. He's going to perfect you eventually, but he understands that he's working with imperfect, sinful people. Perfection is not the goal when you're following Jesus. Progress is. Okay? You hear me, church? It's not about doing it perfectly. It is about making progress in our sanctification so that we can become more obedient and more mature in Christ's likeness. And here's one of the things that I've learned in my life, that one of the reasons why we get stuck on perfectionism is because perfectionism is all about me. Me doing it perfectly. Me getting it right. Me nailing it. Progress is all about me admitting my sinfulness and my weaknesses and making progress in my sanctification as Jesus pours out His grace on me. Perfection is about me. Progress is about Jesus. We have to learn that. Thirdly, failures are great opportunities to learn and grow. Failures aren't things that we don't need to go around the mountain again and again and again. Failures are great opportunities to learn. 30 years later, Peter would write 1st and 2nd Peter. And when you read those books, you're reading a man that is different than the man we see in the early Gospels. Finally, this passage is important because every Christian is called to be a fisher of men. This passage isn't just about God calling pastors into pastoral ministry. And it is about that, but it's also about more than that. Because everyone who knows Jesus is called to be a fisher of men. All of us, in a sense, are missionaries and living on a mission field. Whether it's in our homes, the places of work, our family groups, our social groups, our hobbies, wherever the Lord takes us, wherever the Lord puts us, we are all called to be fishers of men. Now you say, wait a minute, well, I'm not a preacher. Why should I be a fisher of men? Well, let me just stop you for a moment and back up to John chapter 20 in verses 30 and 31. This is why this book was written and why it's important for you to be a fisher of men. Verse 30 says, truly, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Now, if you are a follower of Jesus, you have heard John's testimony and believed it. This is now your story, and you're supposed to share it with others. You are a fisher of men, whether you realize it or not. So, let me give you some next steps. First of all, when it comes to failure, we have to face it. We have to deal with it. One of the things that sometimes people will do when failure happens is we want to take this failure and just put it over here and act like it never happened. Well, that's not what God wants us to do. He also doesn't want us to wallow in it in self-pity. He wants us to face it. In fact, Peter had two conversations with Jesus. He had a private conversation with Jesus, and then later he has a public, very painful conversation with Jesus in John 21. In fact, this is why John 21 is actually in the Bible. Because when John finishes John chapter 20, it's almost as if he put an epilogue on the end of the book. And I really believe as John is the oldest apostle, he's writing the Gospel of John and at the end of the first century, he knows what has happened in the first book of in the book of Acts. He knows that Peter is the preacher and the apostle to the Jews, and he knows all that Peter would do. And so he includes John 21 to explain and to answer the question, what about Peter? He failed, but what about Peter? And it helps us realize that Peter had to face his failure privately, and because he was a leader, he also had to face it publicly. Secondly, when we face our failure, we need to receive his forgiveness and grace. We just need to get over our self-pity and our pride, because Jesus' grace is really this good. It's about him. It's not about us. And so we need to stop talking about our failure at some point. Listen, we do not deserve second, third, fourth chances, but God gives them anyway. I've failed the Lord this week in different ways. And if my failures had to determine my future, I would have quit preaching and ministry a long time ago. And we have to learn how to constantly receive his forgiveness and grace as we follow Jesus. And thirdly, when it comes to failure, we need to at some point stop asking why and start asking what. Now, I know sometimes we need to unpack why we did what we did, why we made those choices, but sometimes we're not going to find answers to those questions. Sometimes we're never going to be able to unpack and understand why and how sin has bent us and why did I do that? Why did I go down that path? And you may not be able to answer that question. At some point, you got to stop asking why and start asking what. So in spite of what I have done, what is Jesus asking me to do now? How can I move forward? You need to stop letting your failure define your future. Jesus' call on our lives defines our future. Not our failures, not our giftings, not our talents, not our money, not our education, none of that. It is Jesus' call on our lives that defines our futures, not our failures. And we're going to learn next week how Jesus calls Peter not only to be a fisher of men, but also a shepherd of the sheep. Until next time, church, I'll see you soon. It's great being with you, and I hope you have a great Sunday.